Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. I'm your host, Jason Turner. I'm available for code reviews and on-site training. And on-site training is a great way of getting your team back together for in-person, face-to-face meetings if you have been working remotely these last couple of years. So you should contact me about that kind of event for your organization. Now in this episode, I need to talk to you about unions. There's a lot of things that you probably don't know about them, and we're going to run through the basics of unions and how things changed with C++ 11. I'm going to try to keep a little bit of a tally right here that lets us keep track of the things that we have discussed up to this point. But before I continue, do go ahead and check out the video description for links and information about this episode and the channel. And note that this is one of the top rated episode requests that I have gotten in the GitHub repository's issue tracker for this channel. Okay, so the first thing that we need to mention is, first of all, unions can be anonymous, and this is a little weird, but this thing doesn't have a name. It just has I and F here. And how do I access this anonymous union? Well, I can do it like that. They don't have to be named. Now, the next thing that you need to know about unions is that only one member can be active at a time. So we're going to put this in a constexpr context so that we can get some of the feedback from the compiler when it lets us know that we're doing something that's undefined behavior. Now recall, constexpr does not allow for undefined behavior during compile time evaluation. Now this code is still going to appear to work because we haven't actually executed this in a compile time context. So we're going to force the compile time evaluation of this and go ahead and mark the result of this may be unused. Okay, here we go. So we are accessing the union member I instead of the initialized union member F. So we have in fact shown here that this is a compile time error because we only have one member allowed to be used at once in a union. We can change the active member of a union. We can in fact do something like this. And we're setting the float member to 4.2, and then we are changing the active member of the union by assigning the integer version here. And if I comment this out, then we'll go back to getting that compile time error. So we need to actually talk about what do I mean by the active member of a union. So a union is not an aggregate of types. It is, well, literally a union of the types. So let's go ahead and look at it like this. Now I need to give it an actual name this time. And by giving it a name, I now need to actually create an object of this union type so that I can access its members here. So it's no longer part of this local namespace. So if I look at the size of this thing that I am now returning from main, I can see that 4 is returned. And what we have is that the size of a union is the size of the largest element of that union, the largest member. These are class types. They look and feel an awful lot like classes in many ways, particularly as of C++ 11. So if I were to add a double to this, now I'm going to see the size of the struct is now 8. And again, we're in the exact same scenario where only the int, the float, or the double can be accessed at a time. So they can be anonymous. Now, don't let anyone else tell you otherwise. This is definitely, no question, undefined behavior to access a non-active member of a union. And that's because that is an object that is not alive. You are accessing an object outside of its lifetime. So a question that you might ask is, which member is the default active member? And the fact is, there is no default active member. So if I do something like this, I am accessing an unactive member of the union, as we're getting this compile time error again from the constexpr engine in our compiler. So you can use a union as a way of delaying initializing an object if you are so inclined. Because I have put a non-trivial object in here, the compiler says that the default constructor has been deleted. So now we're getting to stuff that you probably don't know about unions. So I'm going to go ahead and give this a type name again. And I'm going to give this a default constructor. And now I get an error that the destructor is not defined. So let's go ahead and define the destructor here. We're just giving the compiler some sort of a definition of it so that we can move on. Okay, we've finally gotten to the actual error here, and we can see that S is still not initialized. So I can use this as a method of delay initializing an object, and then I can come back and I can actually try to create this object. And this doesn't actually work. You think that it should work because you're assigning a value to a non-active member of the union. It should make it the active member. But the problem is, this is not actually calling the constructor for S. This is calling the assignment operator for string. So if you actually wanted to use it in this context, you need to do a placement new. And unfortunately, we cannot do a placement new in a constexpr function. So as of C++ 20, what we need to actually do is a construct at call. And it's in my to-do list to make an episode that actually talks about construct at. So that brings us to our next point. But this code actually still has undefined behavior, and it's not entirely clear where that is. So I'm going to go ahead and add it here to make it obvious. So we are actually allocating memory here when we create the string, and the constexpr part of the compiler is now pointing out to us that we have allocated memory that we have never freed. And if you've watched any of my videos on constexpr new and delete, then you know that we actually have to free this memory at some point. So we actually have to call the destructor for that string. And I could put the destructor call up here, and it would look something like, and now we can see that the code does compile again because we are freeing this object at compile time like we are supposed to. But that relies on having actually constructed the object in the first place. So if I were to return 42 from here, instead of trying to access the inactive member of the union, now I'm going to get a compile time error again because I have invoked undefined behavior again, because the destructor is calling a destructor for an object that was never initialized. And there's no way inside the union to keep track of whether or not the object itself has been initialized. So unions have constructors and destructors, but it's almost impossible to actually correctly use the destructor for the union. So that is unfortunate. So let's go back to the constructor and simplify this to using trivial types again, so we don't have to worry about the construction and destruction happening. We can make the choice in our constructor to actually initialize one of the members of the union. And we could, in fact, have multiple constructors so that we do something like this, and at construction time decide which member we want initialized, such as this. And we now have that compile time error because the undefined behavior of accessing I, which is not the active member of the union. Keeping track of all of this and doing it correctly in an undefined behavior-free way is in fact very difficult. But let's go ahead and point out that we can do operator overloading and regular member functions in unions just like any other class type. So now the float is the active member of the union, but if I just did something like u equals 32, now I'm going to get this operator overload that expects an integer. That's going to change the active member of the union, and now this function is going to return 32, and we can see 32 is returned from main. If we wanted a function that gets an int always, well, we're back in a bad place where we just simply don't have any way of knowing what the active member of the union is, so we don't know if we should return I or if we should cast f to an int. So that's a pain. Now it does seem, in fact, that there is a proposal here from October of 2022, which was 3 months ago at the recording of this episode, that gives you a way of actually querying the compiler to see if there is in fact a active member. So there's this is const eval active member question. So at compile time, at the very least, we would be able to check what the active member of the union is. You can see here that's P2641 revision 1 currently. So if you actually wanted to really take advantage of the union for merging types and doing all of the right things, then you just simply have to be smarter about this. And you're probably going to do a combination of techniques. And I'm going to try to throw together something that's effectively a simplified optional implementation that takes advantage of a union in all the ways that we just discussed. Okay, so we have an empty optional here that seems to be working in a constexpr for context. Const eval is forcing this function to run at compile time. But we didn't give it a constructor that allows us to actually create an object with construction. So let's just go ahead and do an assignment here instead to set the active member of the union and initialize it with this value. And theoretically, we can all see this working at compile time. Okay, I am getting this message that storage has not been deallocated, and that is because here I forgot to actually set isActive equals to true when I called this assignment operator. Okay. That was a lot of randomness, but we did eventually get there in a simple, constexpr-friendly, optional implementation that takes advantage of a union to delay initialization of storage of an object, but has to have the manual bookkeeping of keeping track of the active member. So the lesson here should be just take advantage of the standard library types that already exist for this kind of thing. There is one final test that we need to actually perform. And there we go. We did manage to actually make this thing trivially destructible still through all of that. And there's probably a way to simplify some of this. I am using C++ 20 concepts so that I get a defaulted destructor in the case of the union here when I need it, when I have a non-trivial contained member, vice versa. But I hope you found this episode interesting. Key takeaways: unions have evolved a lot since C++ 98, but it is very difficult to use them correctly in any context whatsoever, whether it's trivial or non-trivial members that are contained in there. It takes a lot of manual bookkeeping to make sure you're doing the correct thing. So thank you for watching this episode of C++ Weekly. I hope you enjoyed it. Be sure to subscribe, thumbs up, all the normal things.